we're going to start this panel with a message from Dr. Bielefeldt from Geneva. He couldn't be with us, but he's kindly sent us a message that will set the tone, I think. The three areas of interest for us that was highlighted, four areas were highlighted for us. He's addressed three of them, and it's very important: right to conversion, right to recognition, and education for children, the right of children to be educated without being force-fed ideology. Can we please have...
Yeah.
Thank you.
Hello, everybody. I'm sorry not to be part of your conference, but I'm at the same time quite happy to have the opportunity to say a few words to you. I have chosen three subjects which I would like to briefly focus on, and that is the issue of recognition in the area of freedom of religion or belief, conversion, and then the rights of children. So recognition is a term very often used in the field of freedom of religion or belief, and sometimes governments seem to assume that only religious communities which have received a particular recognition status are allowed to operate in a country. And I would say, I mean, here the term recognition is a source of much confusion, because prior to any administrative or other procedures of recognition, recognition has a much higher, much more principled status. And here let me quote from the first sentence of the first ever human rights document, the 1948 Universal Declaration, which in its preamble states, and here I'm quoting, recognition of the inherent dignity of all members of the human family being the starting point for an understanding of human rights. So recognition is in fact the very first word of the first sentence of the first ever international human rights document. And here recognition has a basic meaning. It's not the result of a negotiation process. It's not the result of any administrative procedures, but I mean, it's a basic insight that without respect for human dignity, human interaction, a meaningful human interaction would not be even conceivable. So, I mean, this is a starting point. This is a starting point for human rights in general, including freedom of religion or belief. So, not only individuals, but also communities can fully operate, can exercise their freedom of religion or belief without any specific government recognition. I mean, recognition procedures, registration procedures, etc., should always come later. The starting point is this is a human right inherent to human beings, to all human beings, just in respect for their human dignity. So we have to be very careful in order to avoid confusion, sometimes deliberately created by governments who want to exercise control. So my next point is conversion. As everyone knows, I mean, this has been a bone of contention for many, many years, for decades, for generations. But again, I would like to be very clear on this. Without the possibility of changing one's belief, freedom of religion or belief would be just impossible. I mean, you cannot have an authentic belief, an authentic religious or non-religious conviction, unless you have the freedom to reconsider your faith, to express doubts, and maybe in the end also to change your orientation. So this is an indispensable part of the human right to freedom of religion and belief. Without conversion, I mean, the rest would remain just an empty shell. So this remains one of the decisive test questions, whether a government goes beyond mere toleration, really respecting freedom of religion or belief as a human right. And then my last point, conversion, of course, usually has an implication also for broader families. If people convert, then they want to make sure that also their children share with them their new religion. Very often governments who try to disencourage conversion, I mean, they really exercise pressure on children. It's a quite despicable, contemptible practice, which I've seen happening in many parts of the world, that government exercise pressure in schools, trying to alienate children from their families. And here it's very important to also have the children's rights dimension of freedom of religion in mind. So, and that includes the rights of parents to ensure a religious upbringing of their children in conformity with their own religion. Again, this is a test case on whether the rights of converts are respected, converts and their families, and the right to conversion is a test case whether freedom of religion or belief has the status of a human right. So one has to see all this in conjunction. Recognition, starting with respect for human dignity and the inherent rights, simply inherent to the human being. In the situation of freedom of religion or belief, the component of conversion, without which the rest would not make much sense. And then as a subcomponent of the right to conversion, also the right of parents to ensure a religious upbringing of their children in conformity with their own convictions, including new convictions. I mean, this remains a package of questions which one has to raise in order to assess the situation of freedom of religion or belief in a particular country. I wish you very good and productive deliberations, and thank you very much for your attention.
The first speaker of this panel, following what we've just heard, is Dr. Nazila Ghanea, Associate Professor in International Human Rights Law from University of Oxford. And we're very happy to have you here with your particular area of expertise, because I know you've done a lot of work on the subject of religious freedom. Shall I read your very distinguished biography? It's in the program. Your thoughts, please.
Thank you very much, and thank you for your kind invitation. Because I'm speaking first after Heiner, I thought it might be worth stepping back and looking at what are religious minorities. We've heard a lot about the insights, but perhaps let's go back to base on what are we talking about in international human rights terms when we talk about religious minorities. So the first element is, what is religion according to international human rights law? Freedom of religion or belief was upheld already in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and then also became enshrined in the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. And there's a declaration dating from 1981, which is quoted in the draft report, which is particularly concerned with freedom of religion or belief. And the definition of freedom of religion or belief, or at least the scope of freedom of religion or belief, has been very consistent in international human rights law since 1948. So freedom of religion or belief has always included the freedom to have, to adopt, or to change one's religion or belief, and then the freedom to manifest that religion or belief. So, you know, we were hearing before about some kind of, somebody used the term as if we are in a zoo. We are allowed to survive, but it's as if we're just an objectification for the sake of tourism. That is not freedom of religion or belief, okay? So already within the realm of conscience, there should be absolute protection for the right of everybody to have, to adopt, or to change their religion or belief, and then to manifest it. And manifesting religion or belief, you know, the expression part of religion or belief, has always been alone or with others, along with others. So you can't have freedom of religion or belief if it's only for you. That is not freedom of religion or belief, or that is not sufficient freedom of religion or belief. We've agreed that since 48, it's reflected also in a lot of regional standards across the world, not only in the UN standards. So it's alone or along with others, in private or in public. Okay, so again, it's not freedom of religion or belief if you can have your religion in your room on your own. That is not freedom of religion or belief. Part of the human right to have freedom of religion or belief is the ability to manifest it, including in public, along with others. And then we have some kind of scope of what how it can be manifested. It's developed most in Article 6 of the 1981 Declaration, but at least we've agreed everywhere in the standards that it includes teaching, observance, worship, and practice. Okay? And that is broad, so it includes pilgrimage, it includes having charity organizations, it includes doing humanitarian work, it includes appointing or choosing your leadership according to your own tenets, not according to what the government says of, I've chosen this leader for you. That is not freedom of religion or belief. That's some kind of objectification or role play to pretend that there's freedom of religion or minority rights, but it's not freedom of religion or belief. And so the having is absolute. It should not be, there should be no coercion in having, adopting, or changing your religion or belief. Okay, full stop. Manifesting, of course, can be limited, but in strict circumstances, according to law, according to a law that is known and is non-discriminatory. So banning, I don't know, a particular Kurdish religious festival would no longer be an acceptable limitation according to the law because it's targeted discrimination. Okay, so it must be according to a law that is non-discriminatory. And the only reasons for limiting manifestation of religion or belief would be protecting public order, health, or morals, or the rights and freedoms of others. And that has to be strictly, narrowly interpreted, and the United Nations Human Rights Committee, which supervises the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, has elaborated on it and would have a view on it. Okay, so it should be decided by an independent court of law, whether it was legal or not, rather than you can't just, as a government, as any government, say, oh, public morality. Because the public morality you limit it on cannot be based on a single religion. It must be on a broader definition and understanding of morality. Okay? So already many criteria set up here. So what are minorities according to international human rights law? They were already protected in Article 20. I know we have many experts, but also we have other experts on the panel who might spend more time on that. But Article 27 of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights elaborates on what rights attach to adhere to minorities. And there's a definition that we have often gone back to in international human rights law, that minorities are a non-dominant population. They're not in power. Okay? If they're in power, they're not a minority, according to human rights law, even if numerically they are smaller. But if they're in power, they're not a minority, according to human rights law. Secondly, they are numerically inferior. They're not inferior. They are numerically in a minority position compared to the rest of the population in a particular nation state. And they have characteristics that they wish to maintain. They wish to maintain them, not the tourism board of the country. There is a solidarity, there's a sense, there's a support by the persons belonging to that minority to continue certain characteristics. And those characteristics include linguistic, ethnic, and religious characteristics. So what should they be able to do? They should be able to maintain their religion, their traditions, their customs, and their language. Now, in the case of some of the religious minorities in Iran, it's customs, it's traditions, it's language, and it's religion. In the case of others, it's really religion or belief itself. You know, there isn't a single religion shared, for example, by Baha'is in Iran or Christians in Iran. Iran's minority policy is very sophisticated. We did a report for MRG a few years ago on minorities in Iran. And, you know, it's interesting to see that religious minorities in Iran have more linguistic freedom than ethnic minorities. In fact, sometimes a linguistic, maybe freedom isn't the right word, but a certain linguistic characteristic is imposed on a particular religious minority community in order to, as a protection against the spread of that religion. So, you know, if all the Christians in Iran were going to speak Armenian, I think, you know, the Iranian government would give them a fair scope for their activities. Of course, that's not appropriate because that's not their language. But, you know, when it's an ethnic, linguistic ghetto, you know, when they can ghettoize it and draw a line around it, they are more comfortable with it. So, you know, can Kurds have linguistic rights? No. But can Armenians? Yes, because it helps the policy of separation, of it not being a threat. So the term minority, of course, is contested in the Middle East the term already suggests that it's pejorative. People think if you say minority, then you're not loyal, you're separatist. It's not a term that is embraced in much of the world, to be honest, but also in the Middle East. But we are not using it, human rights law is using it just to describe this kind of population. Smaller in number, not in power, has characteristics, wants to maintain them. So where does that leave us with religious minorities? Let's bring these two together. Well, as we said, religious minorities may only have claims to freedom of religion or belief, and then as minorities may wish to maintain and continue these characteristics, okay? But they might also overlap with ethnic and linguistic characteristics, in which case the scope of their claims are broader. So what rights should religious minorities have? Well, first of all, as you've said repeatedly, they are human beings, therefore they should be beneficiaries of human rights with equality and the full scope of human rights. Christians in Iran don't only want freedom of religion, they want the right to life, they want the prohibition of torture, they want the right to education, they want the right to health, just like any Iranian citizen. And I think we should also say that human rights are denied to all Iranians, to everybody resident in the territory of the Islamic Republic of Iran, okay? But the reason why we are giving a special focus, I presume, to religious minorities is in addition to the general denials and restrictions and violations, there are additional layers of violations that come from so as human beings, they should have full access to rights. Then they might have a specific interest in their freedom of religion or belief. We've described what that should be. And then additionally, a specific interest in minority rights. We know that all of the minorities we heard from today and those we didn't hear from do not enjoy equality in relation to all of their human rights, not even to the minimal level that is offered to the broader society in Iran. Okay, so first of all, equality in terms of enjoyment of human rights is denied to them. Secondly, and I want to say that all of them are denied that. The extent to it might be different, but I'm not really into comparing suffering. But we heard examples from all the panelists earlier that they don't enjoy equality of enjoyment of human rights, not even in the Citizen Charter, actually. Secondly, their freedom of religion or belief is denied because they don't have the right to have, adopt, or change their religion or belief, and they definitely don't have the right to manifest it in public along with others. So having a school where the head must belong to another religion is not the full scope of your religious activities according to what the community would want to claim. Thirdly, their minority rights are also denied. Now, minority rights norms have actually gone, they emphasize the group dimension of freedom of religion or belief. Religion or belief may sometimes be quite a private matter, and a person may not want to claim the right to publicly manifest it. We hear a lot about a lot of Iranian youth becoming more privatized in their choice of, what their religion or belief is. And of course, that's the prerogative of an individual as well. But the scope of the protection is also to be able to manifest it. The minority rights protections protect that group element more. Minority rights norms, and I'm sure Chris will expand on it, even call upon positive duties for the state to ensure the survival of the characteristics of the minority. It sounds almost bizarre, doesn't it, when we're looking at the context we're looking at, that the Iranian government doesn't only have a duty to ensure equality of access to rights to minorities, religious minorities in Iran, but also to have a positive duty for them to thrive, for their communities to thrive and to survive. Now, having talked about religious minorities, I think we have a more fundamental problem in Iran in that freedom of thought, conscience, and religion is denied all Iranians. Shia Muslims don't have freedom of religion or belief, yeah? I'm not saying it's to the same extent as the daily suffering of A, B, and C, but there isn't the full scope. When you have senior ayatollahs and you have senior clerics that are denied to interpret 12 or Shia Islam, in a particular way, you have a very basic problem. And, you know, to think that we might push the boundaries of freedom of religion or belief for the unrecognized, whilst there are senior clerics that used to belong to the establishment in prison, is kind of a little bit, you know, of course all of these should progress, but we have a very big problem. That's why I want to echo what Heiner said, is that let's not only call for recognition. You know, the Iranian government made a choice very early on to consult with a few representatives of a few religions, even at the time of drafting of the constitution. They know how to play the game of a select representation to make it look good. 10 years ago, I heard that they also have delegations going to other countries like Tajikistan, sharing their model of minority, how to deal with religious minorities. And the Tajiks said, oh yeah, they have a really good policy. I said, really? But anyway, I mean, they even share it and push it, okay? So we are talking for a deep recognition that is about actual enjoyment. Just putting them in the constitution will only benefit religious minorities to the extent that we heard from three of the representatives already today, which is not enough and is not even equality, let alone being a full respect of freedom of religion and minority rights. So let's be careful about the use of the term recognition to actually put the emphasis on equal enjoyment of all human rights, including these two rights.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for these very thought-provoking points that you've put forward, and this idea of recognition as to a full enjoyment, equal enjoyment, is very important. And hopefully in the third panel, where we're formulating the recommendations, we can include all of that and come up with a sentence that we can all then pursue and follow. Chris, with your perfect shot from the camera, it's your turn. Chris Chapman is speaking to us from here, Amnesty. He's the advisor researcher on Indigenous rights at Amnesty International. He supports research and advocacy on land rights, free, prior, and informed consent, and violence against Indigenous women, among other issues. I won't read it all because it's in the program and we're running short of time, I'm afraid. But 15 minutes, the same as Dr. Ghanea. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. Very happy to be here to speak to everybody. It's been a fascinating afternoon. Contrary to what Nazila said, I'm not actually going to talk about the content of minority rights anymore. I discussed this with the Iran team, and I said, "Well, look, I'm following on from Heiner Bielefeldt and Dr. Nazila. I think they're going to cover these issues pretty well." So we tried to discuss what I could talk about, and we agreed that I could talk about what contribution minority rights and freedom of religion and belief make to stability and development, which we thought could be an interesting issue.
I'd like to start off, and I hope you don't mind, this is going to be not a scientific poll, but I'd like to ask you, what, seeing as there appears to be a general consensus that minority rights and freedom of religion and belief are being violated by the government, I'd like to ask you why you think that is, and I'm going to give you three options, and I'd like you to put your hands up. Please feel free, if you don't feel comfortable, don't feel obliged at all, but if you feel comfortable, please do. And you can obviously choose more than one option, because these are complex issues and it might not be just one particular issue. So I'd like to ask you firstly, do you think officials in Iran firmly that they suppress the freedom of religion and belief and minority rights?
Because they think that it is their duty in order to promote the ethos of Iran as an Islamic state? Okay.
Are we saying yes?
Put
your hands up if you're saying yes.
Okay, that's quite a few, yeah. Secondly, do you think that they do it officials do it simply out of their own personal prejudice and suspicion of religious minorities?
Absolutely.
Thirdly, do you think that they do it because they believe they have to keep a lid on the activities of religious minorities and the expression of religious minorities in order to ensure stability?
Definition of stability.
Okay. That's very interesting. Okay. So all of those options got quite a few quite a few votes. As I said, it's not scientific. It's just to maybe get the juices a bit flowing and to get us thinking. So to start off, I have to make a couple of caveats. Firstly, Amnesty is not a conflict prevention organization, so Amnesty doesn't take positions on peace or conflict because they're not human rights issues per se. So much of what I'm going to say is not Amnesty policy. However, some of it is written into international human rights standards. So to that extent, Amnesty would stand by it. And secondly, when we're talking about the prevention of conflict and even social development in society, we're talking about something which is highly complex. We're basically on shifting sands. So it's impossible to say whether this policy or that policy will definitely prevent a conflict, or whether it will definitely lead to greater stability, whether it will definitely lead to sustainable development. Because basically we're dealing with predictions, there's necessarily an element of speculation, but let's call it educated speculation, hopefully.
I just thought I'd go back to something that Heiner said, which I thought was very important. He said, talking about the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, he said, when he was talking about recognition, he said, here, recognition has basic meaning. It's not the result of a negotiation process. It's not the result of administrative procedures, but a basic insight that without the respect for human dignity, meaningful human interaction would not be even conceivable. This is the starting point for human rights in general, including freedom or belief. So meaningful human interaction, I think that is surely the basis for stability and development in any country. So the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Minorities also addresses this issue. The declaration, which was agreed in 1992, which was adopted by the UN, states in its preamble that the promotion and protection of the rights of persons belonging to national or ethnic, religious and linguistic minorities contributes to the political and social stability of states in which they live. The Minorities Declaration was adopted without a vote in the General Assembly. That means that it was a consensus document. Not one single state thought, I don't really agree with this. I'm going to put my hand up and ask for a vote on this. Not one single one. So, broad support. This finding about the link between minority rights and social stability has been supported by academic studies as well. So, the Carnegie Commission on Prevention of Deadly Conflict. This commission carried out a 5-year study which brought together some of the most respected experts and academics in the field of conflict and peace. Their report in 1999 said that to label a conflict simply an ethnic war can lead to misguided policy choices by fostering a wrong impression that ethnic, cultural or religious difference result in violent conflict, and the difference that be suppressed. Time and again in this century, attempts at suppression have too often led to bloodshed. In the case, the accommodation of diversity within appropriate constitutional forms has helped to prevent bloodshed. And it seems, if you look at going back to the Minorities Declaration, that governments agree with that. They supported the UN Declaration on Minority Rights, which is the same conclusion. However, when we look at the practice of many governments, it doesn't reflect that, and it appears that they take the opposite position, that they have to suppress minorities, including religious minorities. It's kind of the approach of give them an inch and they'll take a mile. Like, if we allow them too much, then they'll just want more, and then they'll want us to see. So I think in this regard, it's quite interesting to look at peace agreements which have been agreed in the aftermath of conflicts over questions of identity, questions of minority rights, questions of indigenous people's rights. And I would cite a few examples. So the Comprehensive Peace Agreement of 2005, which ended the conflict in Sudan between North and South, ended, well, not exactly, but yeah, was an attempt at ending it. In Nicaragua in 1987, the autonomy agreement, which ended the conflict between the government and the indigenous and Creole Atlantic coast, the communities of the Atlantic Peace Agreement, which again ended, is debatable, but was an attempt to end the conflict between the government and indigenous peoples of the Chittagong Hill Tract in Bangladesh. In fact, there is no longer violent conflict there, but the issues have not really been resolved. The Dayton Agreement, which ended the war in Bosnia, although this is a highly flawed agreement from the perspective of minority rights, it does contain some minority rights elements. And the Philippines Peace Agreement with the Bangsamoro in Mindanao of this year. And we can even go back a long way to the Peace of Westphalia that ended the 30 Years' War in Europe, much of it which was fought over freedom of religion and belief issues. The Peace of Westphalia contained some of the world's first international guarantees of freedom of religion and belief, guarantees that we would now look back on and find rather weak, but they were at the time quite progressive. In all of these cases, minorities and indigenous peoples had grievances that their rights related. The land rights of indigenous peoples, political participation, failure to respect their unique identity. Now, this is anecdotal. You know, I haven't done a comprehensive agreement in the world which contain minority rights or indigenous peoples' rights clauses. But we can at least say that in these cases, and there are many others, governments were appeared to be, when faced with conflict over identity issues, they were ready to agree to provisions relating to minority rights and indigenous people's rights, which they had not been ready to agree to previously. So it seems that they had made a step forward. You could say that they were converted, not in the same way that Heiner meant, but converted from suspicion of minority rights and freedom of religion and belief to being strong believers. May not have been a very honestly felt conviction, but it certainly was put there in writing. I think it's important to mention that we should not characterize minorities as being necessarily belligerent, that they would take up arms whenever their rights are violated. Often the state is the first aggressor. Point is that if a situation of tension is created, and that might be due to minority rights violations, with the corresponding responsibility of the state, this creates fertile ground for conflict. Small provocations or little escalations on either side can be enough to tip over into conflict. And I think this reflects Monirek from the Baluchi community was saying about how militarization was not the result of the uprising in Baluchistan, but it was more the other way around. Now to talk about development, so I've talked mainly about conflict, but to talk about development, I think that similar arguments have been made. So, for example, the Special Rapporteur on Minority Issues in 2007, she was at that point called the Independent Expert, now the Special Rapporteur, in her report on the Millennium Development Goals and Minorities, she said the specific causes of poverty and weak human development of minorities are often linked to violations of their rights. Minority rights must be at the heart of national and international efforts aimed at achieving and reducing poverty at the global level. So, I think I would also like to emphasize that minority rights protection, we shouldn't just see it, it sounds from what I'm saying, that minority rights protection should be seen as a utilitarian imperative. You know, we need to implement minority rights in order to stop conflict. We shouldn't see it just like that at all. It should never be forgotten that it is a moral imperative, and an imperative based on respecting commitments which governments have made to respect international human rights standards. And also not forgetting that the results of minority rights violations will not always result in open conflict. Of course, we know that there are many rights are being violated openly, which don't descend into conflict, but the result can be, in some cases, political and economic stagnation, where state resources are are sucked into managing the minority, and this prevents the people from moving forward. I can't be an expert, but just putting that out there.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I'm sure there are points that we can apply, and our experts will be able to take that up further.
We move on to Dr. Payam Akhavan, who's recently come to our country. He's decided to honour us. he's now a visiting fellow at Kellogg College, Oxford University. Shall I read your biography? You all know who Payam Akhavan is, I think. No? We don't know you? Okay, so I won't introduce you. And those who are watching, go on our website, and then you can read all about Payam, because it's much longer than what I've put in the program here. Thank you. Dr. Payam Akhavan, thank you. You have the floor.
Thank you to Dr. Kashifi and Dr. Lajavardi for their efforts in organizing this important event and for their kindness in inviting me. And in order to establish my academic credentials, I will begin with a story from Mullah Nasruddin, who is a legendary Iranian. Yes, Mullah Nasruddin features prominently in my biography. And the story, of course, is that Mullah Nasruddin is sitting backwards on his donkey, and everyone is telling him, "Mullah, you're going in the wrong direction." And he shouts back, "It is not me, it is the donkey that is going in the wrong direction." So I say this because the issue that I would like to address, following the two excellent presentations given by my colleagues, is the inverted interpretation of international human rights law by the Islamic Republic of Iran, where freedom of religion instead of incitement to hatred is prohibited. And there is a connection here, perhaps more in the realm of the freedom of expression, where in the Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, states are obligated on the one hand to respect freedom of expression, which of course is integrally connected with freedom of religion and conscience and worship, while on the other hand, the permissible exception and indeed the obligation to limit such expression is where it amounts to incitement to discrimination and hatred. And what we have in effect is an ideology, which I will reflect on briefly, which has done the exact opposite, where an integral part of the propaganda of the Islamic Republic has been from the very beginning and continues to be the demonization of minorities, and of course the notion of what is a minority, as Dr. Ghanea explained, is not just restricted to what we would customarily understand as a minority, but there are minorities within minorities. And I would like to reflect perhaps in a national context as to how we can take international standards and translate them into a discourse and idiom which can be embraced by the Iranian public and not just by our own community of human rights experts and scholars. I want to begin with the assumption that international human rights law are, as Mr. Rejai Khorasani famously said in the UN in 1983, secular man-made standards, which to the extent that they're compatible with Sharia law will be accommodated, but when, of course, there's a difference between divine law and man-made laws, divine law will prevail. And this still remains a basic sensibility in the Islamic Republic of Iran and many other governments that invoke Sharia law as the basis for their constitution. I just spent several days ago, I was at a seminar with the Afghanistan Human Rights Commission, and we see in the Constitution of Afghanistan the same dilemma, where there's a provision referring to Sharia law and another provision referring to international human rights law, and now the national debate is how one can reconcile these two imperatives. And that constitution deliberately leaves unanswered the question of which takes priority. So I will begin by saying that we need to move away from this discourse of the otherness of human rights standards, and perhaps not refer to them so much as international human rights standards, but also standards that have very deep roots in Iranian history. And of course, one always looks at the Cyrus cylinder from 450 BC, Which is what I was reminded of seeing the previous panel with Zoroastrians and Jews and Christians. And in a sense, the story of Persian history is a story of diversity. It's an integral, essential part of the history of this civilization, and it continues to be despite all efforts to homogenize identity as an instrument of power. And one is reminded that Benjamin Franklin, of all people, was deeply influenced by the Greek philosopher Xenophon's book Cyropedia. And in a sense, one can say that this Persian history had a profound influence on the drafting of the Virginia Bill of Rights. And I think that that's just one example of moving beyond this discourse of sort of Western imposed standards and the nativist discourse, which was always at the core of the Islamic Republic. We are reclaiming our authentic self in the face of what Jalal al-Ahmad called Westoxication and blind imitation of the West. And I would even say that we have, in more recent history, the, of course, famous poem of Saadi, which graces the portal of the UN General Assembly. Human beings are members of a whole created in essence of one soul. This is another aspect of Iran's, even if you like, not post-Persian, but at least this Islamic tradition as well, which is a different expression of Islamic civilization, one which is a tolerant, humanistic, and all-embracing. And one of our challenges in the human rights community, I think, beyond emphasizing international standards, is also to clothe those words and terms in a language and context which has a sort of a more intimate and immediate impact for people in Iran at a time when they're engaged in a redefinition of their national self-identity. Moving on from there, I would say that freedom of religion, which of course is the topic of this panel and in specific reference to minorities, is at the core of any meaningful reform of the human rights situation in Iran. This is because we have a peculiar case of a modern theocratic authoritarian state in which religious identity, or more specifically religious homogeneity, is the fundamental basis of state power. So it is not at all a surprise that religious freedom is a highly problematic idea for the Islamic Republic of Iran, because it goes to the very core of the definition of the state in the constitution of the Islamic Republic. And others have referred to the fact that we need not so much look at minorities to understand the problem in Iran, but we can even look at the fact that today we have more Shiite Ayatollahs subject to imprisonment and harassment than we ever did in pre-Islamic Iran. And that in itself explodes the myth that this is really about religion. It's not about religion, it's about authoritarian power. More specifically, it's about abuse of power. So we need also to move away from this politically correct discussion, which is, well, we're talking about state and religion. Well, yes, at a certain level, but more fundamentally, we're speaking simply about the abuse of power. So one could say that the only people whose rights are fully respected in Iran are those that follow Twelver Jafari Shiism and accept the Velayat al-Faqih and are the inner, in the inner circle of power. And one could really reduce that circle so narrowly that the question becomes who's the majority and who's the minority. And we have definitions, of course, of what we mean. But in a sociological sense, I would say that the smallest minority are those that subscribe to this very particularistic, intolerant, and hateful ideology. And perhaps it's exactly for that reason why, in recent years, as we have seen the increased consciousness of the Iranian public, and we have seen deeper and deeper cracks in the ability of the regime to control people, perhaps it's exactly because of this context that we now see renewed efforts at repression and a dramatic increase in hate propaganda against minorities and a desperate attempt to once again revitalize this sort of revolutionary fervor, which allowed the regime, through the construction of imaginary enemies, through othering certain elements of Iranian society, to create a homogeneous self, which would then rationalize and legitimize authoritarian power. So I think that Iran is moving in two very different directions. There is the pluralistic Iran, which is terribly worrying for the hardliners. And part of that pluralistic Iran is what witnesses the dramatic attraction now of Iranian people to different religions, whether it is Sufi Dervish beliefs, whether it is Christianity, whether it is the Baha'i faith, or in particular, whether it's the Zoroastrian faith, which has a particular appeal to Iranians, which may still have a deeply spiritual identity, but who are disillusioned with a religious ideology which has been imposed on them through hatred and violence for so long. So on the one hand, we see at the level of the grassroots a profound cultural seismic shift which wants to embrace pluralism. And in reaction to this fundamental shift, an increasingly desperate series of measures to force the status quo and to prevent change. I would say that this is definitely a losing proposition for the Iranian government in the long term, but unfortunately in the short term, this increase in repression and incitement to hatred could still have catastrophic human rights consequences. So we need to be very mindful of this context. I would also end by saying that we have to be mindful of the fact that while the Islamic Republic of Iran does subject the interpretation of international human rights law to the interpretation, its own particularistic interpretation of Sharia law, that for the most part, the propaganda efforts have become extremely sophisticated. From the very beginning of the Islamic Revolution, when, for example, the Baha'i leadership was prosecuted before the revolutionary courts, the discourse was always one of, we are not prosecuting you despite the fact that you belong to a wayward sect, but we are prosecuting you because you're an agent of foreign powers, America and Israel, and so on and so forth. And we see that the same applies to other forms of religious deviation, which are always politicized and characterized as a threat to national security. So I would end by saying that just as in a society, an individual who is totally unable to relate to anyone that is different from himself has a profound psychological weakness, that we are in effect seeing in this repression and increased crescendo of hate propaganda and intolerance, not a sign of strength, but a sign of a profound paranoia and weakness. I will end on that positive note.
Thank you very much. Again, wonderful stuff for discussion, hopefully in the next panel, and hope to be able to formulate things. The last speaker that we have for this panel, I'm happy to say, is Dr. Ahmad Shaheed, who's agreed to join us here. He was appointed the Special Rapporteur for Iran by the Human Rights Council in 2011, and I think most of us were there.
We took the biography from there.
Oh, okay, we stopped the biography from there. All right. 15 minutes.
Thank you very much. First of all, thank you very much for inviting me to this very, very important event. I'm delighted to join you. Usually when you're the last speaker, after a very, you know, series of distinguished presentations, you're lost at what to say. But in the case of Iran, unfortunately, there's always a lot to say because the government leaves kind of, you know, no end to that. And I want to begin by just doing that, by bringing to the audience here the government's perspectives on what we just discussed. And I have before me a report they published in New York just last week, denying everything, of course. But 3 points I want to highlight here. After listing 4 or 5 points, they say, given the above points, the allegations about the violation of rights of minorities are totally baseless. That's a starting point here. And what are they referring to? Of course, they're referring to Articles 13 of the Constitution, which you know of, and Article 15 as well. And then three very surprising points. One is The Iranian parliament allocates a budget annually for the purpose of enabling non-Muslim Iranians to perform their rituals and ceremonies and education. Non-Muslim Iranians, for instance, had held 140 artistic programs. That's exhibit one, as it were. And then they go on to say the political participation of the minorities has been, I'm reading verbatim here, has been guaranteed seat in the parliament. In other words, saying seat in parliament demonstrates there is no discrimination. And then they go on to add that alongside religious minorities, civil rights of the followers of sects, including the Baha'i, are fully respected. It is obvious that this is contingent upon an individual's performance of his or her legal duties in society, as credibility of any right depends on fulfilling mutual duties. That is their version of what a right is. And they're going to add that Article 3 of the Constitution stipulates that people's beliefs may not be interrogated. So this is the base upon which they're saying we have no discrimination in this country. I cite this not just to point out what Professor Payam said about the inverted reading of international law, but also to point out that Heiner's point earlier about recognition is a very, very valid point. And I want to return to his points about recognition, because often confused as to, you know, what it actually entails in terms of state obligation to respect various communities of believers and minorities. Now, Heiner Bielefeldt, in a report 3 years ago, identified three different meanings of recognition. One, as he said today, is a sense of the due respect for status of all human beings as right holders by virtue of their inherent dignity. That predates any formal approval, as it were, of the person's rights. Second is a state's providing for the possibility of obtaining status of legal personality, which religious or belief groups may need for the extent of important communitarian aspects of the freedom of religion or belief. We often hear of house churches being raided because the government claims they have no license to operate. But that's because they don't actually give any license to operate in that capacity. The third is that the sense of states according a specific privileged status to some religious beliefs or communities. That's what they actually have. So they say we have Article 13 providing some recognition, but then they confuse the rest of it in terms of the obligations to grant everybody their right to freedom of belief and religion. Of course, as you heard today, Heiner also notes that freedom of religion and belief does not depend on administrative registration of procedures, as it is an inherent right. Now, in one of its replies to my reports, the government of Iran recalled that Iran's constitution emphasizes adherence to these religions and entitled to manifest their beliefs within the limits of the law, which are governed by wilayat-e faqih. And as Nazila said, you know, under international law, there are very, very strict limitations, but Iran reads them very, very broadly to mean anything that the authorities mean. And of course, they have the full, if you like, veto on what it means, assigned to the Guardian Council. So whatever their rule is, what Sharia says is what goes in the country. The Baha'is, they have told me in one of my reports that they have curtailed the Baha'i rights to preserve public order and the propagation of beliefs of the Baha'i, and I'm quoting here, incite sentiments leading to disturbance in the case of university order. And then they say the Baha'i are to blame, that the propagation of Baha'i ideas actually disturb public order. So the reason for expansion of universities is that they create trouble in universities and therefore public order has to be retained. Further to this, Iran government has also used a differentiation between religions and sects in order to make citizenship dependent on affiliation with recognized religions, to deny members unrecognized religions the possibility of obtaining status of legal personality. Communities lacking this status are faced obstacles when trying to, for example, establish bank accounts, officially employ individuals to work for their community, or to establish private schools for their denomination. This, in turn, may have negative repercussions on the ability, for example, to obtain property in order to establish places of worship, or may undermine the rights of parents or legal guardians to ensure that their children receive religious education in conformity with their own convictions, as we heard, a fundamental right. And although legal personality status should be understood as an option and not an obligation imposed on religious communities by the state,
So it is compulsory in Iran to manifest beliefs, either publicly or privately. Those communities, for whatever reasons, that prefer not to obtain such status or have difficulty registering as legal entity are therefore penalized. Members of non-registered communities, such as the Baha'i, some Christian groups, and other faiths, experience police harassment, surveillance, or even criminal sanctions, as their activities are deemed illegal by the state or certain state agencies. Restrictive measures include the closing of places of worship, confiscation of property, financial sanctions, imprisonment, and in some cases, even the use of torture. I have received quite compelling testimonies of torture visited upon various visitors of religious minority members. Target groups may include communities that have been denied registration status against their will, and communities not wishing to obtain such legal status because of prosecution that they would face subsequently. Consequently, members of the faiths unrecognized by law, like the Baha'i, live in this marginal system that essentially relegates them to non-citizens, categorically denying their rights openly, and in many instances, privately profess their faith or practice their beliefs. Discriminatory and criminally punitive policies pervade all areas of their lives and subject them to widespread mistreatment or neglect at the hands of public authorities and others. You can't imagine any society in which the top leadership are in prison, as the case of the Baha'i in Iran, and that's what we've been facing in Iran for the past several years. Now, despite recognition, followers of Judaism, Christianity, and Zoroastrianism also face limited freedom to hold and practice their beliefs. In Geneva, I had the pleasure of meeting members of parliament from these communities. What they could tell me was very limited because they had a stenographer taking copious notes of whatever was said to me. But even in that, it was clear to me there was some variance in terms of the government's approach towards me and what they thought was practical and pragmatic. I have reports that despite, being told that the communities there are doing well, I have reports that Persian language Bibles have been confiscated. They have been restricted on when they can hold services, not on Sundays, for example. And as well as those who distribute Bibles are prosecuted. And many are often prosecuted for attending seminars abroad with religious orientation. And these are not limited to the non-Muslim communities, but Muslims face them. As Nazila said, even the Shia community face a very, very serious persecution. I would refer, for example, recent acid-throwing incidents and link it to the Hizbah doctrine, the idea that public are encouraged to promote good and prohibit evil as they see it, is behind this. And therefore, even if you are Shia in the dominant, if you like, sect, if your views were not conforming to the state's version of it, then obviously you had no freedom to practice your beliefs. And equally important, of course, is the question of right to participation. Although Iran claims that having a seat in parliament guarantees participation, I beg to differ on this. You have, in the case of the presidency, that a qualification is that a person must be of recognized political religious convictions and must support the foundation of the Islamic Republic's official religion and beliefs. So therefore, a clear restriction on a base of faith on who can run for high office in the country. Now, we have heard today a variety of presentations regarding a number of communities here, and they are all too detailed for me to recount. But the essential point here today is that, have things improved in Iran over the past 15 months? And my last report makes it clear that they haven't. And if you look at the resolution in New York just last week, the world community of 78 member states believe that they haven't either. And I say this with good reason. Yes, some have been continuing trends in the Ahmadinejad era, and you have seen in some senses the language has become more tempered. You don't hear the more, if you like, disturbing noises we heard before. But in actual facts on the ground speak a very, very different story. And I don't refer here to every faith here, but I'm very concerned with reports coming out of Iran with regard to treatment of the Sunni community there, the Ahwazi, Arabs, and others. And we heard earlier of the conflation of ethnic minority status and religious minority status as being a double jeopardy. And I'm seeing more evidence of that. In Balochistan, for example, they've had reports of capital punishment being used, I think, disproportionately compared to the rest of the country. I've also found that if you were a Kurd, a Kurdish minority person, you would face a more serious sort of, you know, chance of a serious punishment than would otherwise. So I am very alert to developments that seem to reflect a harsh treatment of minorities when they were both religious and ethnic as well. And I am also looking at what trends may you find in Iran as a result of the ISIL phenomenon. What is the impact of the caliphate in terms of what Iran does with regard to their own minorities? I want to end there, and I want to also come back later on at the question time on what I believe recommendations we could sort of take moving forward. But I want to again stress that although we may not see the same language as before, we may not see the kind of rhetoric as before, on the ground things have not improved, and there are signs that we need to be very careful with regard to, for example, the acid throwing incidents in terms of toleration of women and so on, that things in Iran could be actually far worse than they have been in the recent past.
Thank you very much. If I can just follow up 2 points from what you were saying about what they're proclaiming about their achievements. The first week of September every year is celebrated in Iran to mark the end of Iran-Iraq war. And this year there were a lot of celebrations are happening within the religious minority communities to show how they participated as Iranians, not as religious minorities, in the defense of the land when the issues, the Iran-Iraq war was happening. And there were a lot of governmental representations in the churches and in the synagogues and in the places that these things were taking place, the Zoroastrians also. And they were saying the numbers of people who'd given their lives defending Iran. The irony is none of the religious minorities can be employed in any of the, at any level with any of the armed forces today. So these governmental people who were sitting there celebrating the achievements of these people and saying, thank you very much for your sacrifice, we're marking, we're appreciating it, and we are all Iranians, at the same time, they will not employ them. They're not trusted to be employed in an armed force. And also members of, when they keep talking about members of parliament, those religious minorities cannot stand for ordinary seats. They can only sit for their designated spots. In the report that I keep referring to that no one has seen yet, we've gone through the articles of the Constitution and every single legal obstacle in here that impedes equality, none of the religious minorities can participate on any level in political running of the country, because you have to swear allegiance to the Constitution, which violates your right, and also they have to accept a velayat-e faqih. So, and because obviously they're not of that faith and that they don't show practical support of that faith, they are disqualified from that. We've been sent so many samples of people's court verdicts where they've been sacked from jobs or where they've been discriminated against, and they've taken it upon themselves to go to court. The verdicts very clearly say you've been sacked because you have failed to observe Article 2 of employment, which is you have to be a Muslim of the Shia faith to be able to be employed within this ministry or that ministry. So there are some very clear discriminatory laws in Iran in practice, and whatever